Welcome to each one of you this morning. Welcome especially to our fellow members of Emmanuel over in Hayter and Shepherd of Peace in Norfolk and St. Paul's members in Norfolk, St. John's down at Stanton and Trinity in Hoskins. It takes faith, right? We live by faith. It takes faith especially in our world of isolation, our world of separation, to see that we're not isolated, we're not separated, but we're worshiping this morning with thousands around the radio, thousands on live stream, to remember that as we worship this morning, we gather around the word that makes our hope even more secure, right? We're really gathering with many of our fellow believers this morning, and we're worshiping the God who has given us his word that assures us and strengthens our faith in him. Our first hymn this morning, hymn number 223, As We Begin Another Week. Service this morning is printed on page 15 in the front of your hymnals. Please stand. We begin our worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins to God our Father, asking him for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness.
Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful, and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil, and failed to do what is good. For this I deserve your punishment, both now and eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior, Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner.
Lord, have mercy on us. Christ, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy on us.
God, our Heavenly Father, has been merciful to us, given his only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In the peace of forgiveness, let us praise the Lord.
Came to your disciples and took away their fears with your words of peace. We ask that you also come to us this morning through word and sacrament and drive away our doubts and fears with the comforting assurance of your abiding presence. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Pastor Paul Hirsch serving here at St. Paul's Norfolk, as well as beautiful Savior in O'Neill. Going through the same general procedure that, doing page 15 liturgy, but covering the three scripture lessons like has been done in the past. And Pastor Ricks and I switched, and so now I get to spend a little bit of time with the Old Testament lesson, the first lesson that we have this second Sunday of the Easter season. That in the bulletin, I put Old Testament in parentheses or in quotation marks for a reason, that through the Easter season, there is not an Old Testament lesson per se. If we were to follow that formula of an Old Testament lesson, an epistle lesson, a gospel lesson throughout the year, there's a book in the Bible that we never hit, a very important book, the book of Acts. And so in this Easter season, to replace the Old Testament lesson, we have a lesson from the book of Acts, which records the history of the early New Testament church, and especially our first lesson here this morning from Acts chapter 2, where we have Peter preaching his Pentecost sermon, and keeping in mind that this Pentecost sermon that Peter, our text, would have taken place 50 days, 7 weeks after Jesus' death and resurrection. But talking a little bit about Acts chapter 2 and about the reality of news. Certainly there are all kinds of reasons to share news. I would categorize news in three categories. There is bad news, news that isn't so fun to hear. There is news that you go, why did you just waste my time telling me that kind of news? And then there's good news that we rejoice, good news that we have parties connected with, that we celebrate over. I'm a World War II history guy, and I'm going to throw some dates out at you. Dates that, for different reasons, react differently because of the news. The first date I'm going to throw at you is September 1st, 1939. News concerning that date, September 1st, 1939, compared to May 8th, 1945. September 1st, anybody? Our small congregation? Anybody know what it is? What specifically happened September 1st? Pastor Zicky is absolutely right. That's technically the starting date of World War II because that's when Nazi Germany invaded Poland. Generally considered to be the start of World War II. And then you get to May 8th, 1945, VE Day, Victory in Europe Day, when Nazi Germany surrendered and that part of World War II was done, right? Two different kinds of news that were reacted to differently. I can't imagine anybody dancing and celebrating in the streets when Adolf Hitler, Nazi Germany, attacked Poland. But at the end, boy, London, Paris, all the celebrating that would have been going on, incredible. Two more dates. How about December 7th, 1941, and then August 15th, 1945. I'm sure you're getting the gist of this. December 7th, Pearl Harbor Day. The reaction to that news compared to August 15th, 1945, VJ Day. Victory over Japan, the end of World War II. Very, very different reactions of the shock, the fear, the anger that goes along with December 7th, 1941, compared to this picture. Does everybody have this mental picture of the sailor kissing that nurse on the cover of Life magazine? VJ Day, the celebrating that was going on. It's kind of odd that you think of that December 7th and August 15th. That I doubt there were too many sailors kissing nurses on December 7th, 1941. There was no celebrating in those days compared to 4 years later. And this is the thought that goes through my mind when it comes to our Old Testament, our lesson from Acts. That, as I said before, Pentecost. Jews from all over the world were gathering in Jerusalem for the celebration of Pentecost, the Old Testament ceremonial festival of Pentecost. Would basically be considered compared to our Thanksgiving celebration, Thanksgiving festival. And Peter here is basically having two messages, some good news, but first he starts off with some news that isn't so fun to hear. That he's talking to these Jewish people here, and he says something very blunt to them in verse 23 that I'm going to read before too long. He's talking to the Jews in Jerusalem. This man, Jesus Christ, was handed over to you by God's set purpose and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. And you put him to death by nailing him to the cross. Very harsh, very hard news that wouldn't have been received very well. I wouldn't have been jumping up and down. I wouldn't have been celebrating hearing that hard news of me putting Jesus on the cross of Calvary. But that's part of the reality that Peter very truthfully was sharing with his audience. And he wasn't just pointing a finger at those Jews that were gathered in Jerusalem at that time, because he also would have been pointing very realistically, very truthfully at himself. Again, it was just 7 weeks prior to this when we think of those three disciples of Jesus. I think my opinion is that those three disciples get an awful bad reputation for the notoriety of their sins. Peter denying, Judas betraying, Thomas doubting. That we tend to focus on those three sins and how they were reacted to. And yet Peter is pointing that finger, the accusing finger of God's law at each and every one of us. Not just the Jews, not just to himself or Judas or Thomas, but to us. Because all of the times that we sin, that we do not follow through with God's holy demands of his righteous holy law, you and I are doing the same thing. We put Jesus Christ on that cross of Calvary through our sins, through our disobedience. And this is the harsh reality that each of us needs to remember. But Peter also refers to the flip side of that truth. Just a few minutes after this lesson, we're going to be singing through Psalm 16. There's a very pertinent reason why Psalm 16 is included here on this second Sunday of Easter, a psalm written by David. And in our section of Acts 2 here, Peter refers to David's grave and David's decaying body still there in that grave. And what's the connection, Psalm 16, second Sunday of Easter? Well, the connection is that David was a pretty important guy, but yet he still died. He was buried. If you really wanted to, Peter is saying, just turn your eyes over there. You can see David's tomb over there here in Jerusalem. If you really want to dig it up, David is still there. He's still dead. But Peter makes this flip side of the argument and saying, now turn away from David's tomb and let's look at Jesus' tomb. Very different. Very different, because even though David, as important as he was, he's still dead. He was still a sinner. He's still in his grave compared to Jesus. Maybe not as highfalutin and fancy as King David, but more important, obviously. And the difference of tombs? Thankfully, yeah, David, he's over there. Jesus' tomb is over there, and it's empty. Jesus was resurrected. Talk about good news. Talk about those two sides of that coin. The harsh, realistic, bad news of our sins and the incredibly good news of Jesus and what he accomplished for the forgiveness of our sins. And so we look at this and we have this idea of sharing the news, right? Don't you see, don't we see this incredible contrast of the apostles running away from Jesus 7 weeks ago, denying, betraying, doubting. Yet here they are, forcefully, confidently, humbly, faithfully standing up, sharing the word of God to the people around them. The same command, the same encouragement that he gives to us, to share the news, to share this good news of Jesus Christ, which then, doesn't that also dovetail right into us as Christians? Sharing why it is that we can be confident and not paralyzed, not paranoid with this whole virus reality. Let's remember that God is in control. And at the same time, we're going to be careful. Let's follow those CDC guidelines. Okay, the reality of a mostly empty church. But then also, we Christians, not being paranoid, not being paralyzed to say, oh, this virus is not in control. There is no government that's in control. There have always been viruses in the past, and there will be viruses in the future. Let's not kid ourselves. But thankfully, as Christians, to remember this good news, our sins are forgiven, and the good news that thankfully our gracious God, our triune God, is in control of us, control of our salvation. This morning, our first lesson comes from Acts chapter 2, reading a section of verse 14 and then jumping to verse 22. This is on Pentecost Sunday. Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd. Fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. This man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. David said about him, I saw the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body also will rest in hope, because you will not abandon me to the realm of the dead. You will not let your Holy One see decay. You have made known to me the paths of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence. Fellow Israelites, I can tell you confidently that the patriarch David died and was buried, and his tomb is here to this day. But he was a prophet and knew that God had promised him on oath that he would place one of his descendants on his throne. Seeing what was to come, he spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah, that he was not abandoned to the realm of the dead, nor did his body see decay. God has raised this Jesus to life, and we are all witnesses of it. That's the end of our first scripture lesson. Let's sing our psalm together this morning, Psalm 16, the Psalm of David.
Good morning, I'm Pastor Zicky, and I serve Emmanuel and Hader. Grace and peace to you, brothers and sisters in Christ. It seems as if most things these days are up for debate, aren't they? And I think that we kind of like it this way. We like things being up for debate. Now, maybe you're not the kind of person who enjoys getting into a heated debate with somebody, but just pause and think about the fact that those political debates that we have on television, even people who aren't particularly interested watch those debates. There are millions of people viewing them. Go to YouTube and type up debates. You can find debates on religion and science and politics, again, with millions and millions of people tuning in to watch these. A lot of high schools even have their very own debate team, a group of young men and women who travel around the state and sometimes even travel around the country for the sole purpose of getting into a debate. So many things seem like they're up for debate. However, not everything is debatable, right? Nobody's going to stand on a stage next to somebody else and debate them on whether or not gravity exists. You can just drop a pen or a pencil, hit the ground, gravity exists. Things that have been proven. No one would argue over whether the sun provides light, whether a human being needs oxygen and water to live. Things that have been proven, things that have been proven to be facts, aren't things that are debatable. And one of the things that sometimes slips into that category of debatable, though it shouldn't ever be there, is Christ's love for us. Christ has proven his love for us, and he's proven it with undisputable proof. Now, I don't think that Christian congregations gather together and argue with each other over whether or not God loves them, but But I think that a lot of Christians have that argument going on in their heart. They have that old man saying that God doesn't love them. And one of the things that they use as evidence, as proof that God doesn't love them, well, they use things like hardships and trials and illness. These are things that prove that God doesn't care about me. That they use situations like what we're going through right now. Worry and fear over sickness and money and housing and food. The old man whispers in the back of our mind, see, that's proof. That's proof positive that God does not love you, that God doesn't care about you. Even though our lesson will tell us this today. Though now, for a little while, you may have to suffer grief and all kinds of trials. But this isn't proof that God doesn't love you. This is proof that we live in a sinful world. And when we desire, when we chase after the wealth and the happiness, satisfaction in this life, we're chasing after what our lesson will call silver and gold. Now, if you don't know anything about silver and gold, you at least know that at some point it perishes, it'll waste away, it'll be destroyed with the world. It's a kind of treasure that's here today and gone tomorrow. And when we chase after those things, we're chasing after things that God says, this will, and we know this will waste away. This will be gone. It's here for just a moment. Whenever we find ourselves chasing after those earthly things, chasing after things that are here today and gone tomorrow, we need to stop and remember the facts. Remember what has already been proven. As surely as there is gravity, as surely as the sun provides light, as surely as oxygen and water are necessary to live, just as sure Jesus loves you. And it's not up for debate because it's been proven. It's been proven in the fact that Jesus led that perfect life we couldn't lead. He died the death we couldn't die, and he rose before we could. The ultimate proof, the ultimate picture of love, true love, is what we focused on last Sunday, on Easter Sunday. If you want to see proof of whether or not God loves you, the evidence can be found in that open and empty tomb. There's your proof. And what Christ gives you during that, or in that image, is not like gold or silver. It's not going to be here today, gone tomorrow. That would be, all things considered, a pretty lousy gift. If God just gave you things that you could enjoy for just a little bit, and then they'd be taken away from you. But rather, the gift of love, the gift from God, is eternal. Can't be taken away, can't perish, and it's yours. A reading from 1 Peter. Chapter 1, verses 3 through 9. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In His great mercy, He has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. The inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who, through faith, are shielded by God's power until the coming of salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In all this, you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have to suffer grief and all kinds of trials. These have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith, of greater worth than gold which perishes, even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor when Christ Jesus is revealed. Though you have not seen him, you have loved him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him, and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy, for you are receiving the end result of your faith, the salvation of your souls. This is the word of the Lord. We'll continue with our next hymn, hymn 158, verses 1 and 2.
On Easter evening, I would imagine there was some debate going on. Some people had seen Jesus and others hadn't, and I'm sure they were talking about this and trying to sort it all out and maybe even debating how could someone who is dead come back to life. The debate stopped, though, when all of a sudden Jesus was in their midst and he points to the wounds in his hands and his side and his feet, and they get to see him and talk with him. The debate would have gone away. One was missing, though, right? Doubting Thomas, we call him. Thomas said, "Unless I see those nail marks and put my hands there, I will not believe." Faith in the resurrection isn't something that we can come up with on our own. Right? This is outside of the realm of anything that we have seen in our life. Someone who was dead start breathing again, open up their eyes, start talking to you intelligibly, eating. We haven't seen that before, so to believe that, we can't do that on our own. Or to believe that along with Christ's fulfillment of resurrection, he says about us that those who believe in him, that we too will rise again. That is almost even more difficult to believe. We've never seen that happen either. That's why it's so difficult to believe. There have always been scoffers. During Jesus' ministry, it was a group of people called the Sadducees. They laughed at the resurrection. During Paul's ministry, he goes to Athens, and he's talking with these people up on the high of their city, and he talks about the resurrection, and the people, they didn't know that word. They didn't understand it, so they wanted to hear more about it, and they doubted because of that. You and I, fellow redeemed, we confess this. That we are able to confess, "I believe in the resurrection of the dead, and I look forward to the life of the world to come." That's not something that is because of something we have done or credit. We don't deserve any credit for believing this. All the credit goes to God, the Holy Spirit, working in us and in our hearts. We confess that too, don't we? "I believe that I cannot, by my own thinking or choosing, believe in Jesus Christ my Lord, nor come to him." Our human nature, ever since the fall, it's so far removed and separated from these simple gospel truths that the whole message of Jesus and his death for us and his resurrection, it sounds like foolishness to us. Doubting Thomas, we'd be there too, right? Except for the work of the Holy Spirit. Not that this excuses Thomas, though, because he had been told, Jesus told him he would rise from the dead. Not that this excuses Thomas either, because he had the Old Testament scriptures too that he could have studied. He was told, and still he doubted, and still he demanded proof. "Unless I see these nail marks, I will not believe." That wouldn't really be faith, would it? "Unless I touch them, unless I see it with my own eyes, I won't believe." That's not faith, right? What is faith? Faith is believing something that we can't see. Faith is trusting something that we can't prove. The writer to the Hebrews defined faith for us. He says, "Now faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see." The Bible's filled with examples of faith. There was a jailer in Philippi who went to Paul and he said, "Brothers, what must I do to be saved?" And they said, "Believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved." Not do something or perform something, simply believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved. This jailer in Philippi had never seen Jesus, but he was to believe the words of Paul and Silas. Believe and you will be saved. Our faith, the faith we will confess and the faith we do confess and stand on, it's not just in something uncertain. We have the powerful Word of God. There was an argument this week about what has all power and what has all authority in our country. What is it? It is this Word. This powerful Word that we proclaim and that we gather around, this Word has power not only to impart to us the facts of what Jesus did, but this Word also, accompanied by the Holy Spirit, it convinces us that this Word is true, and it also moves us to trust these words for our salvation. That's what saving faith is. It's not just believing that Jesus existed or believing that these events happened, but it is believing and trusting that when Jesus died on the cross, my sins were paid for. And that Jesus' resurrection from the grave guarantees that I will live again. That is saving faith, and that saving faith comes to us by the Holy Spirit through these words. And Jesus proclaims to Thomas, and he proclaims to you, blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. Blessings. All sorts of blessings come to you. Jesus came to his disciples that night, and he said, peace be with you. It's just one of the blessings that they have from believing that Jesus is their Savior. Before Easter, they might have been in the most peaceful areas, hanging out by the Sea of Galilee on a beautiful night, or hanging out in a home with Jesus as he taught them. And yet, their hearts might have had all sorts of gnawing doubts about who this Jesus was or whether their sin was paid for. But after Easter, and after the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit came to them in a powerful way, then they had a lasting peace. Then, no matter what their conditions in this world were, whether they were getting arrested or questioned or mistreated, they still had peace. They knew very well that all things were well between them and God. They had peace for their souls. They knew their sins were forgiven. May God give you this blessing of faith, this blessing of knowing that through Jesus, through his life, through his death, through his resurrection, you are at peace with God. Forgiveness of sins is yours. Life eternal is yours. Our lesson for this Sunday after Easter, the gospel lesson, is recorded in John chapter 20. On the evening of the first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw Jesus. Again, Jesus said, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you. And with that, he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven. Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, we have seen the Lord. But he said to them, unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe. A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. Then he said to Thomas, put your finger here. See my hands? Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe. Thomas said to him, my Lord and my God. Then Jesus told him, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name, the gospel of our Lord. We continue with hymn 143, stanzas 1 and 5.
You to join with me in confessing your faith, we'll use the words of the Apostles' Creed this morning.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Usually at this time in the service, we would have ushers going around and gathering the offering. We know that isn't taking place in our churches today, and it's not taking place in your living room. Yet, offerings are still a part of our worship life, aren't they? Please remember those offerings to your church to support the ministry of the gospel. Do that in whatever way your church has encouraged you to do that. They've communicated that to you. Please find a way to continue to give your gifts of love to your Lord. We continue now with our prayers. In our prayers this morning, we remember Mark Ellenberger. And we also, from St. Paul's here in Norfolk, and we also remember Skip Deck. He's from Trinity over in Hoskins, and we remember both of them in our prayers. Let's pray. Dear victorious God, creator and ruler over all, we give you our thanks and praise for your mercy, which moved you to come to earth as our brother and save us from our sins and from the eternal death we deserved. We give you thanks for coming to us, letting us see in such a real way through the eyes of the disciples and through the experience of Thomas that you truly did rise from the dead. Thank you for your love that reached out to call Thomas to believe and also calls us to believe. Lord, when we are afraid, remind us of the peace you won for us. Let us find our strength and confidence in your victory over sin, because through faith we live with you.
Work in us so that we may live our lives for you. Lead us to be a blessing to the people around us. May your love for us move us to love one another in the words we speak and the things we do. As we continue to figure out how to live our daily lives, dealing with the realities of the COVID-19 virus, give us wisdom. Keep us patient as the weather changes and gets nicer, and we want to be out doing things so that we may do best what is best for our entire community. Let us be wise about what we do and how we do it. Be with our leaders as they deal with both the necessity of returning us to some type of normal and the reality of not wanting to get more people sick. Most of all, dear Lord, lead us to turn to you. Where there is faith that is just born, protect it, dear Lord. Where there is faith that is growing, may your word cause it to grow. Where there is faith that has been, where faith has been, cause it to mature and to be a shining light of strength and stability in our world. Protect your children, dear Lord, from whatever may threaten them. We ask this in Jesus' name. Almighty Father, you alone are the source of every good gift that we enjoy during earthly life. Please do not allow us to take the gift of good health for granted. Please be with and strengthen all who are sick and suffering. We keep especially Mark Ellenberger in our prayers. Thank you for the care he has received in the past few days through his surgery, and we ask you to bless him with a quick recovery, and if it be your will, allow Mark to return home as quickly as possible. Strengthen both Mark and Joan and their family and friends in the most comforting promise of your care and grace. Keep the Ellenbergers in your gracious care and bless them with your almighty power and love. Lord, it was surprising to us this past week to hear that Skip Deck had to be taken down to Omaha with complications to his surgery that he had a couple months ago. Lord, be with him and his doctors. Grant them wisdom and your guidance. Grant especially, Lord, healing to him as it suits your will. Most of all, Lord, be with him in his faith. Strengthen him in his love for his dear Savior. Keep him strong in his trust and reliance on you. Be with his family and friends that are praying for them, for him. We ask this in the name of our Savior, who has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Almighty God, grant your church the Holy Spirit and the wisdom that comes from above. Let nothing hinder your word from being freely proclaimed to the joy and edifying of Christ's holy people, so that we may serve you in steadfast faith and confess your name as long as we live. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Receive with believing hearts the blessing of our God. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Our closing hymn is hymn number 160, This Joyful Eastertide. Again, for joining us for worship this morning. I'm Pastor Rod Ricks from Trinity over in Hoskins, and we so much appreciate that you've tuned in this morning and given us the opportunity to share God's word with you. May the Lord bless your week. Pastor Hirsch, Pastor Zicky, Pastor Schultz.
We just had, what does that mean? We just had a meeting here in St. Paul's.
Oh, yeah, microphone is closed. Thank you. I feel like Neil Diamond now every time I do this. Just had a meeting and having some input from our guys, our folks, our leaders, and talking about this, and people are very kind in saying why this thing is, and it's fun. It's fun to work together with these guys and do this on a temporary basis. Wouldn't mind doing it for the, whatever, you know what I'm saying. But they were saying to our guys at our meeting, were saying to give the other guys a chance to say good morning to their folks, to shake hands, so to speak, after church. And so that's what we're doing. I'm just going to say that personally, to say good morning to our folks, St. Paul's, Norfolk, and the folks over Holt County, paying attention and following with God's word. It's a blessing to do that with you in a very unique circumstance. Also saying thanks to Mrs. Spreeman. Thank you, Shannon, for tickling ivories for our organ and our singing this morning. Appreciate that a whole lot. So that would be St. Paul's Norfolk shaking hands. You got a mic?
All right. Well, Emmanuel handshaking time. Good morning, everyone from Emmanuel, everyone everywhere who is listening. Just a special reminder from what I said in my little devotion there is that this is an easy time to let those doubts about God's love and God's plan to sort of sneak into your head. But the big point I want to get across is the fact that Jesus loves you and cares about you and is taking care of you is not up for debate. There's some things that we can debate and disagree on, but he's already proven it. And that's an important thing to remember. We're only 1 week after Easter, and it feels like it's been a long week after Easter. But that truth stays the same now, and it stays the same for forever. So just a special reminder to do that. And also just another reminder of the office hours. I will be over at church on Monday from 5 to 7, and then on Wednesday from 10:30 to 12:30 in the afternoon. So feel free to stop by there. Just a devotion, prayer, whatever you need. God bless your week.
Say good morning to everybody that I'm privileged to serve here, and good morning to you guys, and thanks to the tech people. I think you guys got missed there sometimes, but you've always been here when we have, so thank you for that. But greetings to the folks in Stanton and Shepherd of Peace, and I don't have office hours like that, but the church is Saturdays, I'm keeping it open. People are stopping in and picking up bulletins and whatnot, and there's some masks still in our entranceway for anyone. That they're the most beautiful masks that you could probably cover your face with, so use those. For the sports people, I know that sports are shut down all across our country and maybe even the world, but there's some bike races that go around the church in Stanton, and my kids are doing that regularly right now, so a couple of them have taken the training wheels off, and if you would like to come and watch them or ride circles around the church, come on down to Stanton, plenty of entertainment. God bless your week. Thanks.
And greetings to the folks over at Trinity and Hoskins. You know, I was thinking today, I was in and out of the sanctuary a couple different times, and you know, church is always a peaceful, a comfortable place to be. But I go in there right now, and it's kind of a sad place to be because it's always empty. There's never any of us there, and it's will be good to have you guys back at worship. So looking forward to that day when we can gather again for worship services at our church. Lord's blessings to all of you. I'm often at the office during the week. You may stop over there or give me a call and see me whenever you would like.